Greetings and hallucinations to all you folks out there, and you are going to be having hallucinations by the end of this cast because we're going to do something we haven't done in a long, long time. We're going to tackle a sentence epic. This game is well over an hour. I'm going to burn as much of it as I can before we get down to the plus one, zero, minus one range. Hopefully I won't dip into the negative. Got nothing else running on my PC, so hopefully we can get through this without dipping too much. And this is between the top players of Forged Alliance. We've got a 2700 rank that is Galactic Fear, the infamous, and we've got Blackheart, Pachirichu, VIP, and a whole bunch of other people that everybody knows about. The lowest ranked player in this game is 1800. So this is a random sentence, that is random faction, random starting position. That is the only way these guys will play nowadays, because that pretty much eliminates the balance war in the lobby. And let's go ahead and introduce everybody. We got Obfuscation. He is taking the blue Cybran. And then on the beach, we've got Gallantry Free, otherwise known as Tenuo Cox SC account and a variety of other names. He is UEF on the beach. On the front, we have Seraphim for Blackheart. Blackheart versus Galactic Fear. I'm sure we all wanted to see this at some point or another. Pachirico, he is going to be Aeon on the beach. Let's go to the north side. We've got VIP, UEF. Actually, that was Rock. UEF on the beach for the northern team. Foley, Seraphim, Air, and Lanalus as Aeon Rock. I'm sorry, guys. Had to sneeze. And Galactic Fear, as aforementioned, UEF on the front. Now, just a comment about the matchups. We got Seraphim versus UEF. That is a very even matchup on the front. Aeon and UEF, that's going to be a pretty good game. We're seeing mirrors in both navies. My goodness, cannot get it started here. And then we've got Seraphim on the north air and Cybran on the south air. Now this is going to be an interesting matchup because Cybran has all of the sneaky units, stealth ASF, stealth strap bombers, and some very interesting, if not the best all-out game ender options. May see a telemajor at some point, who really knows, but you can always borrow a T3 engineer from somebody else to build their stuff. And then on the north side, this is going to be the big deciding factor. We've got double resource allocation versus single, which always makes for an interesting game because people have to try innovative things. Now up front, right off the bat, Galactic Fear is going to gain a huge advantage because he brought an engineer with him to front. That means he's going to reclaim way more mass than Blackheart is. That is something that you get somebody who's extremely experienced at Settings versus someone who may not play Settings exclusively all the time. And you get much more intricately developed build orders that may do a lot better at certain things. So that engineer is going, the attack move order out here is going to let it reclaim the Salem and a couple of wrecks without actually moving into land. And then he's going to run in and grab these wrecks in the back. We'll check the reclaim numbers in just a few minutes to see how that turned out. Now all the way in the back, Blackheart is running freaking Selens all the way to the air player's base. That is gonna go all around up here. Not sure what in particular he's looking for. He's a little bit late to snipe off a snipe off an engineer, but that is actually an interesting idea. If you were to get back soon enough that you were able to actually kill off an expansioneer. So here's an interesting thing. Gallantry Free SC account has managed to get interceptors across and factory lock Lanalus, but Lanalus got his transport out so early that he was actually able to get his engineers onto the island, and he's going to have a land factory up before this even drops. So I think SC account is not really going to have a whole lot of hope of getting a foothold on the island. And then on the front here, we've got Rock assisting front. He is going to shoot a T1 bomber across. That's probably going to go directly after the build power, have a T1 anti-air on the case. It will be around and mobile and stationary, so that bomber is only going to get one pass if it does go for that. Nope, it is going to go up this here way. So that is a quick rundown of the early game. See where everybody's at, how the breakdown looks. And I think we can get an accurate representation of the mass. Blackheart has some more back at his base. He ran down Galactic Fear in order to snag some of the mass on that side and then grab his own mass as he retreated. So he may actually come out okay despite not having the engineer there. Galactic Fear pulling 8,000 mass off of front, which is just ludicrous. There's a little over 12,000 total, if I'm not totally mistaken. So he got way over half the mass. Only 4k for Blackheart, although he is going to mop up a little bit more in the back. He's probably not going to overflow to his team much. And then we've got Beach coming in with a bomber. He's also going to bomb out the front player. Build power going down, got engineer dead. That was an expansion here and didn't even get his mechs finished. So sad, and two engineers dead with some damage to the P-Gens in the back there. So got to get some interceptors over there to help out his teammate. And that is going to be the settling point of the game. Now we get to watch the tech up phase where everybody is teching their mechs, trying to tech faster than everyone else while not leaving themselves vulnerable to a counterattack. See, there's this delicate balance there where you don't want to get Navy rushed, but you don't want to build Navy if you don't have to, because that's more T2 mass extractors that you could have that you might be missing out on if you did go Navy. And it's kind of like this really fine balancing point that requires a lot of scouting to have up-to-date information. There's a very, very fine line between having two more mass extractors upgraded than the other person does and having your entire shoreline run over with frigates. Now, we have a transport coming in. This is loaded up with tanks and arty. It's gonna drop right next to the land factory, and the interceptors are just gonna miss it. And arty immediately firing on that mass extractor, need to lock the factory down, and that is gonna be lethal. Tanks immediately starting to build. There goes the arty, and gotta lock that down. There we go. See, if the arty hits, it destroys the unit inside, effectively factory locking the player, and that's gonna go down. Tanks are gonna take out the mass extractors, and that is a expansion denial for laneless and expansion denial. I should use proper English. Got a yellow bomber out here. It is helping out Galactic Fear, not like he needs help. And Blackheart is going to fall back ever so slightly. Gonna throw down a T2 point defense. He does have T2 on his ACU, which makes it uber strong. Galactic Fear also has T2, so it's pretty much exactly symmetrical. They have almost identical mass incomes. They both have T2 on the ACU, and yeah. So bombers are going to take care of these units down here. Unfortunately, there was not an engineer to start an expansion with, but I don't think Laneless was willing to sink the mass into a development on this real estate. He was strictly looking for a denial tool. Kill some T1 mexes, deny those, force a rebuild and a re-upgrade, and kill off the land factory. Just in general, cause a bunch of mayhem. Ow. And I just kicked my desk. And now here comes the Navy rush. So we've got frigates headed across. There is a naval factory going down and anti-air turret going up as well. So frigate's going to be a little bit late. I think the Navy will be established, and that's not going to work out for them. Got another drop on the northern side. Copycat, but a little bit later. Interceptors are going to snag that one. No problemo, and that is the end of that. I never thought I would see this day. VIP, a 2,000 rank player, is rushing a T1 sub across to the Navy, which is kind of hilarious. He is going to try to pester this frigate to death, and I'm not sure what else, because those are hover engineers, and yeah, that is that's at most an annoyance. That's it. Okay, so we've got T1 bombers coming across. This is something that I have expressed a lot recently, and I would stress it to everyone who has not taken this lesson to heart. T1 bombers are never out of style. T1 bombers on a suicide run, if you kill two or more engineers, pay for themselves. And when you have dense packing of engineers like you have with factories. I'm sorry my voice is so broken up, guys. As for those of you who don't know, this is one of six pre-recorded casts that I did, so I'm two casts deep at this point on the day that I'm recording these. I am currently AFK. I am either getting married or honeymooning or on the way down to get married or driving or doing something gloriously fun, not involving work and not near a computer. So, yeah. My voice might be a little bit rough, but we're going to get through this. That is for sure. T1 bombers are always handy for killing off build power, and that just puts such a huge damper on the party of the person that you're throwing them at. It's actually kind of hilarious and incredibly annoying, and part of the reason that this anti-air turret is here. So, fronting with a lot of interceptors and or using stationary anti-air on the water is crucial. So Blackheart has decided that he does not like Galactic Fear's base being here. He had quite a few tanks, but those tanks have since been decimated by the vast number of turrets out front here. I'm not sure if Blackheart has the... He may have... Yes, he does. He has Nano Regen, which makes him way more survivable and much more healthy than just the stock ACU. And he's still going to get chased away by the point defense, did a bit of damage, but not nearly enough, and he's going to get forced back. But he does have Ilshis on his side versus the Riptides and or Pillars from the UEF T2 phase. And to be completely honest, that just won't hold up. It doesn't work out. Blackheart sacrificing HP in favor of getting mass, and I'm not sure how good an idea that is, actually. He is looking kind of peaked at the moment, down to 10k health, half health. He does have that enormous amount of regen. He will very rapidly get back up to full health, but for the moment, is not going too hot for him. Got torpedo defense going up on this side. Pachuriku is trying for a little bit of defense versus these frigates and subs that came across. A few minutes ago, I was actually kind of making fun of VIP for the sub rush, but he did complement it nicely with a good mix of frigates, and that's actually a pretty lethal little raiding force. The subs can be targeted on any incoming frigates. The frigates can be targeted on factories and build power, so that he can eliminate any build power that Laenalus has, and Laenalus is more than likely going to have to convert to hover spam at some point to drive this back, and then the T1 subs are just going to be an annoyance. But we do have some T1 torpedo defense going down that is going to help tremendously versus the subs. And notice that he is building them slightly apart so that the very, very tiny amount of AoE that is involved in a T1 naval battle does not interfere with more than one torp defense at a time. One of them is going to go down and immediately get rebuilt, and he's going to keep healing those, gradually whittling away at the health of these units until finally there is nothing left. Then he can suck up that oh-so-tasty reclaim, and it does amazing things for your economy. Now, Galactic Fear is doing the nasty here. He is tack launching the Beach Player's base, who has not built TMD because he's expecting his front player to deny stuffs. Gallantry Free complaining, "You should have said something sooner, Cancer Noob." SC account calling Blackheart a Cancer Noob. That is a new one. Oh my word, he's even tacking the build power. SC account's gonna rage on this one. That is a crippling blow down here, especially considering the fact that we have a vast horde of frigates on its way southward, accompanied by a shield and a destroyer. Not exactly the thing that you want to be coming for your bay at this point in the game. As I'm sure 100% of you already know, but I'm going to talk about it anyway. Rock has a huge, and I mean gargantuan, ginormous eco advantage over Beach. Fighting Beach versus Rock is a losing battle from the start unless you can be aggressive enough to actually deny entry to the water. And Galactic Fear is being pestered by T2 Torp Bombers. Well, those are going to be... are going to continue going on, but he's close enough to land. No big deal. Yellow is a bit behind on air, actually, at this point. Anywho, moving on from that. Forgot what I was talking about before I went on that little side trip there. ODUL. Oh, the eco advantage. So Rock has one more mechs than Beach has to begin with, and then you have the islands. That's a total of 6 mechs advantage. That's a whole lot of mass. So if you can get into the water and succeed in not being denied by the beach player, eventually you win, just because of the mass advantage. Unless you're like Cybern versus UEF or something, in which case UEF can build enough battlecruisers and summits to just run over you regardless of the eco advantage. But we don't have a case of that here, so no big dealio. It is UEF versus UEF. Wait. Oh, somebody donated an engineer. That was nice of them. Well done, team. Getting that tech in the water. Okay, so that is actually kind of an odd decision, because the Aeon T2 is, in theory at least, and in practice, more than likely stronger than the UEF T2. So I would have actually gone with the Aeon T2, at least initially. It's kind of strange, but hey, he's rocking it, so we're not going to knock it. So we've got a cruiser here at the mid that is going to be a thorn in Blackheart's side, who you will notice is actually back up to full health just a few minutes after his drop to 10k health. Galactic Fear throwing down an upgrade. That is a T3 upgrade? T3? There's so many glowing lines that I can't even see what the upgrade is. Yes, that was T... Nope. Yep. Nope. Yep. Yep. T3. I'm going to assume it's T3. We'll see in just a second. T3 Air Scout headed around the outside edge. Of course, all intelligence is vital, especially when you're on a 20k map and there's all kinds of deep and dark secrets held by the opposite end of the map. Let's take a look at what intel we have gathered. Yes, see, not even a single scout has hit the back end of the base in the first 20 minutes of the game. And looking at the other side, very nicely scouted. Good intelligence all the way around. Maybe not incredibly recent, but you can see that it's there. Now, Foley has slightly less ASF, but way more economy. He's got a couple extra T3 mass extractor as opposed to obfuscation, and part of that is due to the double RAS, or lack thereof, concerning the respective parties. But what will happen is Foley, who is ahead on mass, when he starts ramping up his production, will absolutely obliterate the production of obfuscation. Now, it's going to get a little bit interesting because you have the factional differences with Cybern versus Seraphim Air. So, honestly, either party can negate the other's strengths by using their respective strengths against each other. So, I am very intrigued to find out how exactly this plays out. Alrighty then, so we got T3 Navy for VIP. He's going to start pushing battlecruisers. That is going to totally negate anything that the Aeon T2 destroyers can do. And on the other side of the map, we also have T3 coming out for laneless. That means summits are well on the way, and T3 for SC account as well. Is that a summit? Yes. That, no. Yes. No. Nope. That's a battlecruiser. That, my friends, is a battlecruiser. So, taking a look at the eco, laneless pulling 379, a full 150 plus over SC account. Holy hell, that's a lot of mass. Wow. Pachirichu pulling 408, king of the eco at the moment, and his opponent VIP is only pulling 285. So this is a glorious showcase of how Sentence is an asymmetrical map, but it is symmetrical between the two teams. Kind of weird, but it works. And also, holy cow, at 21 minutes and everyone has all T3 mechs and they're already capping them. And that's just awesome. Okay, so T3 push. Galactic Fear did indeed get the T3 upgrade. That is going to allow him to build the infamous Ravagers and begin forcing Blackheart back. But the thing is here, Blackheart has already got his T3 artillery spam well underway, which is going to completely and totally stall anything that Galactic Fear can do as far as advancement, until he can manage to get a fat boy up or something. We've got 7 artillery so far with the I'm not sure how to say it, the glorious strength of the Seraphim nano regen comm out in front. And actually, if he could throw double nano on that, you know, you can get up to the 60k HP mark, single-handedly take on T4, throw that other gun upgrade on there, and you'll be able to wreck all the T3 as well. It just gets awesome, awesome stuff. So that is something to consider. And one thing that may end badly, though, this is going to be symmetrical, so it's not that huge of a deal, but we are going to be dealing with this in just a minute. The fact that the land neck is so narrow means that when one or both Navy loses, whichever Navy wins is going to wreck the opposite front player. Now, if both Rocks win, which, let's face it, typically happens in any game with even matchups, both fronts are going to be obliterated and the entire map is going to rotate clockwise as far as land holdings. And that's what I typically see happening on a lot of Settings games, unless there's a game where the air player and the beach coordinate to beat the Southern team and the Southern Navy, and then the Rock player is strong enough to, without air support, beat the beach player, which does happen occasionally. It makes for a really cool game when that happens. It is rape of the highest order and pretty much just owning everything that the other team is doing. Ah, the impeccable precision of the T1 bomber spam coming in. That is going to start wrecking the world of these T3 artillery. Not exactly a high-tech tool, but hey, it does the job. That bomb, that one is just about dead. If it were not for the veterancy, ah, bomber crash, killing two. Nope, just one. Hold on, what was that? Is it a radar? That was, I think, a single bomber crash just killed two T3 mobile artillery. I've never seen that happen before. That is fantastic. May have been the bomb. I don't know. But it was cool nonetheless. All right, Blackheart taking a lot of Ravager fire. He's back down to half health again. Maybe his regen can get him back up into the safe area relatively soon. Right now, he's kind of begging for a strat snipe being out there so far. And near. Not the best turn on the face of planet Earth, but it'll work. Nice recovery, swinging around behind. Does not have the stealth turned on his ASF, which means that Yellow saw him coming from a mile away, which would have helped, and he's broken formation, and now he's in front. No! There's an air loss. Ugh. Cybern ASF are significantly weaker in group formation than the other factions' ASF are. Then a 1v1 matchup, equal numbers in a patrol interaction or a stop interaction, the Cybern ASF actually win. They are much, much, much better when they're tracking on their own or when they're in, you know, like small group confrontations or whatever. But one bad turn when you're clumped up like that and Cybern ASF just get mutilated because of their lower health. They die in one fewer volley than any of the other ASF do. And then they waste a lot of their DPS on common targets in the middle of the big groups, and it's just sad to watch. So, Galactic Fear saving the day on that naval confrontation, assisting the battlecruisers of his teammate with a bunch of Riptides. That's going to give a slight naval win to VIP. And the Navy is divided at the moment. The northern side is failing due to these T2 torp bombers that are just shredding everything on the water. And the beautiful Aeon destroyers, or not destroyers, battleships. I do love Aeon battleships. They are my second favorite. I am one of the oddballs that actually doesn't prefer to use the Summit. I appreciate the Summit's strengths, and I do realize that it wins most all naval confrontations in the T3 stage, but as far as just the coolness factor and how much fun they are to use, I like Cybern the best because it has that rapid fire rate. It can take care of hover on its own. It just looks so cool. And then Aeon battleships, you know, they have the shorter range but the brutal DPS. It's like an advanced battlecruiser, and they just do really, really well. I love them. So that is that. And the VIP's Navy is not in a winning position by any means, but it is looking a little better thanks to Galactic Fear's hover tanks that have come in. And it's actually going to start looking a whole lot better even because all of this build power is going to go down. That is the key in the late game. Killing eco doesn't do a whole lot because there's so much reclaim everywhere that it doesn't make any difference. If you have mechs, if you don't have mechs, as long as you have an engineer to reclaim with, you can build anything that you want. So your primary targets need to be power, kill the power generators, or to kill build power, because if they have mass and power but they don't have any build power, well, they can't build anything anyway, so it doesn't even matter. Pachirichu, by the way, is up to 471 mass income, which is nothing compared to the 505 being pulled in by Laneless. That is incredible. Where is he getting all this from? He doesn't even have his T3 mechs capped with fabricators. That is very strange. 505, that has got to be reclaim value. That has got to be reclaim value. Nope. Rock solid 506. Well, learn something new every day. Well, you can tell how much I play Rock. I don't play Rock that much. The eco numbers are surprising to me. But I do understand them, considering the fact that he has 17 mechs. This is my weakest slot by far. I'm a halfway decent front. Beach and air are my best slots, although I'm not a pro at either one of them, and I very rarely, if ever, play Rock. It's pretty much only when it comes up in a randoms game that I play Rock, and most anybody can beat me from Beach because I just don't know the builds. So we've got strats coming in. These are going to be after the island, actually. I am zooming a bit too far over and missing the main target of all of these strats. I'm going to go after the mass extractors, try to kill a little bit of that eco over there, but as I was discussing earlier, not a whole lot of point in doing that because you're going to leave the reclaim out there. There's engineers out there to get that back. Reclaim the wrecks of the strat bombers, and hey, everything's back to normal, all hunky-dory. And no difference at all. Now, Foley is pulling 408, and Obfuscation is pulling 593. So, whoa, hold on. That is a 348 and a 394. So, Obfuscation is significantly ahead on his mass pull. That is mostly thanks to the T2 mass fabs that he has got going up all over the place, and which Foley has none of. Foley is overflowing only 2,000 mass, 1,300. That's actually very, very good economy balance, because once he maxes his mass out, he will actually be perfectly fine. And we're running at zero speed. I can back this speed off and everything's good. All right, so that's Foley. Obfuscation is pulling plus 8,500. So he either needs more mass fabs or to stop building power, because he is overflowing. Laneless minus 123 on the mass, but with a good buffer in his storage. Pachirichu looking brilliant with his. And I forgot to look at the reclaim numbers here. Let's see, we got 8K, 9K, only 7. Well, he has not made much progress. That is probably the reason why. Now, once he starts reclaiming behind his advancing navy, we're going to start seeing all of that, all the numbers go up. 22K and rapidly climbing for Pachirichu, mostly because he had all of this navy in his base and now he's trying to reclaim some of it, and that is contributing to his awesome navy prowess. We've got VIP pulling in 5K, barely. Again, same problem. He is not reclaiming behind his advancing units, but I'm sure he will be shortly, considering the air cover and awesome advancements that he's making. He does need to grab that mass, because if Pachirichu gets it, there is no hope left for that Northern Navy. Gallantry Free has 10k mass, which is very impressive considering the fact that he's pretty much been camping this whole time. Galactic Fear was 17k thanks to that little bit of advancement there, and then Blackheart with a whopping 19k. Kind of an odd mass reclaim distribution. Not what I would have expected to see. So we have 5 summits. 6 summits, but only 2 bulwarks, 3 bulwarks. 4 bulwarks. Bulwarks keep popping up everywhere. And that is compared to 3 summits on the other side, but Laneless does have way more battle cruisers, which is probably going to be the deciding factor in this, as these are moving into the build power and factories. So I don't know who's going to win on this. SC account has done a remarkable job with what mass he has. He's up to 339 mass income. And then on the other side, we've got 1 summit and 2 battle cruisers versus 3 battle cruisers, a battleship, and a summit. So, north side's not looking very good at all. The torp bombers are definitely helping. Foley is able to turn some of those out, but he is falling even farther behind Obfuscation, who is still churning out those T2 mass fabs to increase that oh-so-glorious economy. You always want to be upping that eco. That is the main goal of Settings. Eco, 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 eco. Even to the point of building a Paragon, because that is ultimate eco. And that is a very impressive power grid you have there, sir. Nice P-Gen distribution. Now, the cool thing about this is, if you have a grid like this, if you kill one P-Gen, it damages all the ones around it down to like 1,000 health. So if you plant three P-Gens, or three Strat Bombers on this one, and then one Strat Bomber on all of these surrounding it, you will then create a chain reaction which will actually kill the entire power grid. Because once you trigger a couple of intersecting P-Gens and start the chain, you end up with a bunch of P-Gens at 1k health or straight up dying. And that works out really, really, really well. Galactic Fear is really after those flapjacks. He's trying to break the shield strength of this Seraphim firebase. So many T3 artillery. So many T3 artillery. That is crazy. And Strat Bombers coming in to affect the shields as well. UEF just does not have the shield strength that Seraphim has, but their shields do build faster than Seraphim does. So spamming shields works a lot better as UEF than it does as Seraphim. But when you have this many T3 mobile artillery, it's only a matter of time until all of your shielding cracks. And then it just sucks. So I'm not sure who's going to win that. The first turn was kind of ambiguous, but with that turn, that was a bit of time for Cybern to be behind. If this is executed well, that is a perfect turn, and that looks pretty good. I think overall Blue is going to come out ahead on that, although it wasn't a complete and total win, but that stall from Yellow is going to clinch it. He's turning back in. He's already outnumbered. That's going to be a complete and total air win for Blue. Obfuscation going to take the lead in mass income, score, power output, all the way across the board. He is ahead now of Yellow until that turn right there. But he's got all of his other ASF coming in, so I think he'll be fine. If he would just use his dang stealth, that's all he's got to do. Use the freaking stealth so he can't see where you're coming in from on your first turn. The one and only strength that his faction has at air, he's not using, and now he's lost it again. Holy cow. How does that even work? You had like three times as many ASF as he had at one point in that fight, and then lost it all the way back down again. That's just absurd. Okay, so Flapjacks have now defeated a Seraphim shield formation and are now tearing a new one in these T3 artilleries. Strat Bombers are also helping the situation, by the way. I did not forget about those. I don't know why he's not targeting some of these artillery on the Flapjacks. The base is not that vital. If he kills these, well, there's more streaming in by the minute. So, not sure exactly how that's going to work. So many summits just need more bulwarks. More HP, more health, more shields. That is the answer to all the world's problems. So we now have 5, 6, 7 summits over here. The straight up summit spam is actually working reasonably well for VIP. I am surprised at how much progress he's made. Also, T1 bomber spam. Lots of T1 bomber spam. Shutting down the ASF spam in favor of T1 bomber spam. Not sure what the point of that is. Also, there's a nuke. Who launched it? There it is, right there. Red is the culprit. Laneless is going to shoot his beach opponent, I think. Yes, that is headed. We will find out. I thought I saw the red tick here somewhere, but I lost it on the way. Okie dokie then. I'm wondering if the T1 bombers were an accident because he just started ASF spam up again. Maybe not. Maybe the T1 bombers are actually meant to do something. Maybe they are after the T3 mobile artillery. That would actually be cool. Knock all of those out for his teammate, and that would be the end of that. There goes naval production. Kaboom! So many NGs cruelly murdered in the nuclear holocaust that is a strategic launch. That's also the T3 Naval HQ going down in that. The only good thing strategic in this situation... launch detected. Oh, look. Another nuke. Ah, he waited till he had two loaded. Nice. Okay, the only good thing about this is that he already has so many summits up that I think the gap in production is not actually going to kill him, which is kind of surprising. Red is catching up on production, and he has far more frigates, but we have all of the Huther spam down here, and another nuke is coming in to impact it. This is going to get a little hairy for poor little Gallantry Free over here. And the T1 bomber is still streaming in, killing off a significant amount of those T3 mobile artillery. So sad to see you go, my friends. Bombs, TML, Ravagers, the entire world is against you. Looks like a desolate wasteland of wrecks here. Look at all of the corpses littering the battlefield. We've probably hit critical mass on wrecks, and there's the nuke. Kaboom! Bloedier. Who is Bloedier? I think Obfuscation is Bloedier. If I'm not to... Yeah, I'm pretty sure about that. So this is Bloedier. I've never seen Bloedier on Sentinels. That explains a lot, actually. That really does explain a lot about how this game is going. Okay. So, North is not looking that great, actually. We have a Tempest online. Building Tempest is not the greatest idea. More build power, more factories. He needs a second UEF T3 factory to eliminate this ugly roll-off time. And throw some build power on that and be building more summits. Because a summit is better than... A single summit is better than a single Tempest. Now, once you start stacking Tempests, I think the Tempest does stack better than the summit does. Because it has more AoE. And it has the same reach and just the brutally front-loaded damage. Plus, you have the torpedoes involved. So, there is that. But as far as a microed summit versus a microed Tempest... The summit will actually win. If they're both standing still, the Tempest will win. But two summits do beat a Tempest, and that is less mass. So there is that. There's another nuke. The northern team is the team of the nukes here. We've got two for red, one for yellow. And Galactic Fear just spamming the ever-living hell out of shield generators because that's what he does best. UEF, the turtle faction. This is one of the few times that I don't feel bad about the turtle. Okay, I'm not sure how many of you knew this, but there is actually a limited number of wrecks that can appear on the map at any given time. And once you create more wrecks than that, it starts erasing the old wrecks. I don't know what that number is. Somebody probably does and will probably post it in the comments. But there is a certain point, and I actually figured this out. I think I had read it somewhere, but like I hadn't made the mental connection that it was actually a thing. I'm sure you guys know what I'm talking about. That thing where you read something and go, oh yeah, that's probably right. And then you immediately forget about it. And you don't ever connect it to real life, and you don't ever think about it actually being a thing. And then one day you experience it for yourself, and you're like, oh my goodness, it all makes perfect sense. And my moment of that was when I was playing as an air player, and I just had too many units. I needed more unit caps, so I started control-K'ing T1 engineers everywhere. And I actually control-K'ed a group of like 400 Harbingers, which you would say, why did you control-K 400 Harbingers? It was a stupid modded game, and I basically had infinite eco, so it didn't even matter anymore. The unit cap mattered more than the 400 Harbingers. I control-K'ed them and went back to reclaim the mass as I was building something else, and the wrecks weren't there. And I'm like, why is this happening to me? And then I realized that I had hit critical mass of wrecks. So that's a thing. If you ever wonder where all the mass went, that is where it went. The wrecks just up and disappear after a certain amount of time. Or a certain amount of wrecks. There's a critical mass. That is what I'm trying to get at. Riptides ripping through the build power. They're going to get down here and bite into that. As before mentioned, critical target is the build power. Always, always, always. That is why this nuke was far more devastating than this nuke. Second nuke, honestly, I would have hit the other area of build power because that would have been more crippling than losing four mass extractors and a couple of P-gens. That is my humble little opinion, but, you know, I always freely offer it, whether people listen or care or whatever. So T3 Mobile Artillery is building back up again a little bit, not quite as many as he had before, but enough to stall the advancement of Galactic Fear. Galactic Fear is just building more shields in the same spot instead of more shields in the general direction of this base. But here comes Yathotha! And, you know, even if that dies to Ravagers, if he just walks it into the middle here, the Lightning Storm will kill all of the shielding in that area, and it'll be a net win. The fire base will be broken, it'll take way too much effort to get the thing reestablished again. T3 Artillery moves forward, kills the thing as it's building, and bam! No more UEF fire base, all due to one single lonely Yathotha. I'm not even sure if that's how you pronounce it. Some people call them Yolos, some people call them Yodas. I don't know what the correct pronunciation is. All I know is that it is a gangly, strange-looking chicken, and it is very useful for spawning a lightning storm. Okay. Hover spam. Not a match for an equally massed group of frigates. Oh, something I've always wanted to do. Let me do this. Gallantry free. How much is your navy worth? 126,000 mass. Ever since I got that mod that shows this, by the way, if you search softly in the mod vault and press the search key, don't hit enter, that will pop up. It is a little readout that gives you the exact mass value of any group of units that you select. I've always wanted to know how much a well-mixed navy is worth, and apparently it is worth a paragon. Yeah, that's how much mass is out there. You could build a paragon with that. But then you wouldn't have a navy and you'd be overrun, so it's a moot point. I've been talking for entirely too long. I need a drink. I'm a do the do. Sponsor me, Pepsi. I've always wondered, as high profile as Coke and Pepsi are, like, there's literally no one that has not heard of Coke and Pepsi. And I really don't think that any amount of ads would influence anyone in the United States either way about either product. So I've never understood how they can justify the amount of money that they spend on advertising. Because Coke and Pepsi could literally stop advertising completely and not advertise for a full year, and I guarantee you that people who buy Pepsi will still be buying Pepsi, and people who buy Coke will still be buying Coke, and people who don't care will still be going into the restaurant and picking whatever lemon lime or dark colored soda is there. So, end rant. There is so much mass in this ocean. Good gracious alive. That's like six summits right there just in that one spot, accompanied by a whole bunch of battleships and a whole bunch of destroyers. This is the most surprising part of this game to me. The fact that VIP is actually not only holding up, but advancing against Pachirico. And let me check the mass here. That is 73k versus 40k. So there's even less reclaim on this side. I don't know what's going on here unless it's just bad unit mix and faction advantage. Because the UEF summits are undeniably better. And now that there's summits going down over here, the eco is winning again. So Pachirico is probably going to start pushing and shove orange slam out of the ocean on the other side. But between the micro and the unit mix, having the factions mix there, and everything else going on, Orange was able to hold out for so freaking long. Alright, March of the Chicken has begun. It is on its way. Why did the chicken cross the road? To release a violent thunderstorm on the other side is the correct answer. It's going to be moving across along with this massive frame rate loss. And I should probably, zoom out a little bit here. Too many ASF. Oh, minus two. No, CPU. Keep up, CPU. Strap Bombers going after Galactic Fear. And this is the power of the Athatha. It has so much AoE. Zap. It actually does fare better in a lot of situations than the GC does. I used to think the Athatha sucked because I would always put it up versus a GC in like Turtle Wars and stuff where you're just pitting T4s against each other. But in real life situations, a single Athatha is a lot of times as good, at least possibly better than a GC is. Now versus each other, the GC wins. And more GCs is more powerful than more Athathas. But a single Athatha versus a single GC in a real game situation, the chicken is a dang good unit. Do not underestimate it. That AoE is amazing on the two main cannons. I mean, one of them's got like 7 AoE for crying out loud. It can kill multiple Percivals at once. And that is an impressive survive right there. 1,000 health. It's going to take some Ravager. Might get out of it. Nice little bit of zigzaggy dodgy wadgy. And nope. T2 artillery right in the back. And it's gonna go down. I wish this ASF engagement would end so we could go back up to minus one. And finally we have the right idea here. Well, he's pulling them back together. For a little while, Obfuscation just let his ASF wander. And that actually did him a lot of good because, like I was talking about earlier, in a patrol order collision or a stop move order, Cybern ASF will win hands down every single time versus the ASF of another faction, as long as the numbers are equal. It's where you run into bad micro that you start encountering major, major, major problems. Okie dokie then. Cool story. A couple of nights ago, I was playing a game where, actually, it was a game where I died to fire beetles, and it was highly embarrassing. But anyway, so I'm observing, and one of my teammates was standing right next to a chicken that was walking past him. He stepped out of the water, and he was about to overcharge the chicken, and I was saying, don't overcharge it. I was about to say, start reclaiming it, because, you know, if you kill the chicken, the lightning storm comes up, but if you're reclaiming it when it dies, it doesn't spawn the lightning storm. The Athatha had 10k health. He overcharged it and placed the reclaim order, and the ACU started reclaiming the Athatha in the time it took for the overcharge to travel to the Athatha. So he reclaimed his own lightning storm out of existence with his ACU. It was one of the most badass things I've seen in Supreme Commander. ACU single-handedly walks out of the water, bludgeons a chicken to death, and then eliminates the lightning storm from said chicken single-handedly. It was awesome. I loved it. Okay. That game was not worth casting, though. Like, it really wasn't. There was so much stupid stuff that happened and not a whole lot of redeeming strategic factors. So, before you ask, no, I'm not going to cast it. Besides, I tried to make a habit of not casting my own games. So, there's the nuke. Foley is launching away. It's so bright and shiny. Oh, I know why everything is bright and shiny. I turned Bloom Render back on. That's what it is. I would really appreciate some comments as to whether or not I actually want to keep Bloom Render on. I had it off for so long, I forgot what it looked like just about. Everything is so colorful. Also, the shields look glorious with Bloom on.
Strategic launch alive. Detected.
Aeon's like little waves. Oh man, I'm like a little child sometime, like a dog with a squirrel. Got ADDDDDDDDDD. So this nuke is going for naval production on this side. I don't think there is an anti-nuke close enough to deny that. El Nopo, and another nuke down this airway. That is going to probably land on the naval production down there. So this is going to put a little bit of a damper on the party for Blue. Pachiriku was so good. He was making advancements. Everything is going well, and there went 80% of his build power. Maybe he still has enough to hold. He needs to retract to a common point so that he doesn't overextend his now thinning line of units that's advancing. But overall, oh, Was that a nuke? What was that? Is that a Billy? That is exactly what that was. There's a Billy on the front. Oh, why am I slowing it down? It's running minus one. Alright, so spam TMD. Galactic Fear is still building that thing. Oh, we'll catch it when it launches the next time. Okay, so SC account also had his slate wiped clean, so to speak. Not looking good. There are so many nukes on the north side. So many nukes. We got two over here. We got one there. And then we got the Billy on the front, which is probably about to collide again. Ah, there's the launch. Alright, there's Mr. Billy. He's a rolling. He's a rolling. Question is the TMD gonna catch him? Where'd it go? I lost which dot it was. No! Okay, I think. Nope. Is that it? Okay, it's dead. TMD got it. Alright, so TMD has reached critical mass, apparently. There's two or three there. So Billy's not gonna work anymore. And there comes the real nuke. Blackheart, don't die! Don't die. Oh, nope's too far away. Well, Blackheart's not going to have anything left. That's for sure. Nukes just shredding everything. This is not looking so good for the Southern team. This is looking okay. And we also have the air win, so that is going for them. Obfuscation has 100 mass per tick higher income than Foley does. Lainel is pulling 605, Pachirichu 586. Blackheart is the weak link in the chain, a 300 mass per tick deficit below Galactic Fear, which is understandable considering he just got nuked into oblivion. And now we're minus a eco. Minus an eco. Failing English once again, my fiance would hate me right now. And there is the Billy.
Ah! Not the naval production!
It's actually an ideal target for Billy's. Only 26 kills? Really? You can nuke, Billy nuke, engineering... Stumbling over my words here. Done too much today, my brain is dying on me. You can nuke engineers, clumps of engineers, around air factories, around navy factories, whatever you want to do. It is a highly effective tool at reducing build power quite hilariously. And you can rack up an ACU with like 600, 700 kills very easily. Load it up in a T3 transport, drop it within striking distance of clumps of engineers, and just have yourself a heyday. Launch away. There's an Atlantis. I was not expecting to see that. Atlantis accompanied by 8 summits. It's actually more than a match for the Navy that's on the board at the moment. Is crazy, yo. And more Billies. I think that was an attempted ASF Billy. That is another thing you can use this for. You can actually pull air denial if you're good at aiming the Billy. It is possible to nuke clumps of restorers out of the air as they fly towards you. It is absolutely rage-inducing and completely hysterical when you do it. People get so upset with you. But yeah, anything you gotta do, do what you gotta do. More nukes. Anyone who does not have nuke defense at this point has brought it upon their own heads. There's 3 loaded here for obfuscation. I would get another nuke defense if I were any of these people. I would not rely on one because one can be sniped. 2 is always better, and the Billy continues to go off. I'm just gonna have to kind of like zone out that nuke. And as soon as I zone it out, an ACU is going to go up in a violent explosion. I'm going to have no idea what happened. And here goes a nuke for the island. It is possible to nuke the entire island with a perfectly placed nuke. You can kill all of the mass extractors on the island and just about all the units. So very, very handy. It is pretty much worth it. If you have all T3 mechs on the island, you can expend a nuke and it pretty much pays for itself. By the time they rebuild it in lost income, it probably paid for itself. Let's all watch the pretty fire. And boom. I did not expect my CPU to drop this low. I'm running 4.6 gigahertz on a 3570K, which is a pretty decent processor. This is probably the top 20% on FAF at the moment. I very, very rarely go way negative for extended periods of time. A minus one is about the most I see. And I don't think I've been the slowest person in a game in an extremely long time. So we've got Siren Tech in the back here. It would be very handy to have Aeon Tech at this exact time, because Aeon TMD one-shots the UEF Billy. It completely and totally negates it without any trouble at all, and that is pretty much critical when you're in this kind of situation. TMD building like crazy here. Alternately, you can get a shield generator, as long as the shield generator has more than 12,000 health, and you can use the shield generator to block Billies. Works brilliantly. And my voice just cracked. Hallelujah! My voice is finally given out. I'm gonna start yodeling or doing whatever I want to do. ASF colliding. Here we come. Negative sim score and holy hell. Strap bomb collision, a glorious blaze of light. All of the ASF have been killed by the strap bomber collision and by the other ASF. And that's going to be, once again, a complete and total air annihilation for Obfuscation. He is making up for his earlier sins in air with just total domination at the end. Oh, man. This Billy's just getting sad. Just continuing to eat away at the mid here. Got a fat boy moving in. So many flapjacks. And the map is rotating clockwise, as predicted. This rock one eating into the base on this side. This rock is kind of at a standstill because of nuked build power, but it was advancing, moving in that direction. He will again as soon as is humanly possible. And more Billies. Cannot get enough Billies. They have aircraft carriers off the shore. At least they're not building anything. That could be bad. This is bad, though. We have torrents coming in. Those are going to have the oh-so-massive range that the Aeon rapid-fire missile ship has. You can see that range on there. That's going to be able to park here and reach this entire base. So if the TMD can hold up, which it probably won't because the TML is specifically designed to break TMDs on these ships, once that TMD gets eliminated, all of this is just going to go up in smoke. And the battleships here can actually reach these, so that's going to speed up the process by a whole heck of a lot. I thought it could. What was that? Oh, yeah, that one can. Just barely. Actually, if this one moved up right there, it could reach those. That's what he needs to do. He needs to kill off all that TMD there. If he can do that, he's home free. Shielding going down. And Blackheart is the proud owner of a Galactic Colossus. Not sure why, but he is. More Billy! That's what this world needs, more Billy. I'm actually kind of happy that Galactic Fear chose to do that. Oh my goodness. SA account kills me sometimes. Alright, so air control is a thing.
Strategic launch detected.
But I'm not really certain how on earth this can actually be used. I think we're watching the slow, inevitable folding of the Southern team. Obfuscation biting it. He is going to take a bow, get out of the game, say, done with this. I'm going on to the next one. I think that's going to be the wrap for them as well. All right, so there's the folding over there. My goodness, this game must have lagged to all get out, because it said the replay was like an hour and 16 minutes long when I was on here before. But SC account, nope, SC account is going to be his typical dickish self and control K the entire base, because that's just how he do. I don't know why he does that. That's just absurd. Anyway, that is game. Gallantry's out. Everyone eliminated. Everyone's dead. Blackheart has fallen. We now know that Galactic Fear is better than Blackheart, at least on Seton's front. And ranking is actually a good indicator of who's going to win. Haha, at least in this situation. So that is Seton's epic. Hopefully you can learn something from how that was executed. Not entirely one-sided. Air and Rock won on the south side, and Rock and Front won on the north side. But you can obviously see, once you totally lose a Navy, it is pretty much no going back. The Navy can fold that side, eliminate the front, assist in air control, and overall just overwhelm the map. So well done to the Northern team. And there's a thunderstorm brewing outside. I don't know if you can hear that or not, but it is about to start storming. So, I'm going to get out of here. As always, guys, thank you so much for watching. I will see you in the next video. And then, of course, on the last week of May, I'll be back. May have K at the moment. May not be able to tell it because you're seeing cast like normal, but I promise I'm not here. All right, I will see you guys later.